A latent image is an image on an exposed film which hasn't developed yet and is still unseeable. But the image is still there, waiting to form fully. And this is the character arc of the emergency medical hologram in Star Trek Voyager's Latent Image. At the end of the episode, Janeway leaves the doctor alone in the holodeck as he struggles to overcome the limitations of his programming, to accept that he can be swayed by friendship and feelings rather than cold calculation when in a medical emergency. And as the episode closes, the doctor lifts the book of poetry which Janeway had been reading, entitled La Vida Nuova, or The New Life, by Dante.
In that book, which is my memory, on the first page of the chapter that is the day when I first met you, appear the words, "Here begins a new life."
And that is the essence of this story. The birth of the Doctor as a new life. This is the turning point in his story. And this is why Voyager...
It's as though there's a battle being fought inside.
This is the moment we never got for Data. Instead, his development is a gradual, decades-long development into a new life, fully risen above his synthetic limitations. But for the Doctor, this episode depicts the internal conflict within him, the program versus the person.
I didn't deserve to keep those memories, not after what I did.
Doctor.
Doctor, hardly. A doctor retains his objectivity. Two patients, equal chances of survival. And I chose the one I was closer to? I chose my friend? That's not in my programming. That's not what I was designed to do.
Deactivate the EMH. It's as though there's a battle being fought inside him. Between his original programming and what he's become. Our solution was to end that battle. What if we were wrong?
We've seen what happens to him.
Still, we allowed him to evolve. And at the first sign of trouble, we gave him a soul, B'Elanna. Do we have the right to take it away now?
Enlightenment philosopher Immanuel Kant argued that personhood is defined by an individual's ability to produce and process reasons as they decide to take action in the world. In the episode, the doctor must choose to either save one patient, Harry Kim or Ani Jatel, or let both die. And when he chooses Kim, he finds himself caught in a logic loop, struggling to understand his reasoning for saving Kim rather than Jatel. And when he concludes that his friendship with Kim motivated his decision, he is thrown into chaos, for friendship isn't in his program.
When I'm faced with a decision, my program calculates the variables, and I take action. For example, two patients, for example, both injured, for example, both in imminent danger of dying. My program needs to ascertain which patient has the greater chance of survival. And that's the one I treat. But what if they have an equal chance of survival? What then? Flip a coin? Pick a card?
Doctor.
Two patients. Both injured. Both in imminent danger. Oh. Don't touch me.
Something's wrong with him.
Don't you know it's rude to refer to somebody in the third person? You had a choice, Mr. Neelix. Should I do something rude or not do something rude?
Doctor, we must return to sickbay.
What if I don't want to return to sickbay? What if I decide not to return to sickbay? I don't choose this. Leave me alone. Let me go! Why did she have to die? Why did I kill her? Why did I decide to kill her? Why? Somebody tell me why!
It is at this moment, when the Doctor has developed as far as he could without reaching the limitations of his emergency medical hologram programming. His rationale for a medical decision was rooted in feelings of friendship, something very human. Robert Picardo's performance is mesmerizing as his character sinks into a whirlpool of self-conflict. But his character isn't the only one to wrestle with the nature of personhood. In a pivotal scene, Seven confronts Janeway concerning her decision to erase the Doctor's memories again.
Having a little trouble regenerating?
I am having trouble with the nature of individuality.
There's a time and a place for philosophical discussion. 2 a.m. in my quarters isn't one of them. Meet me in the mess hall tomorrow.
Tomorrow will be too late. We'll have already rewritten the Doctor's program by then.
And violated his rights as an individual. I considered these issues 18 months ago, as I did again this morning. I came to the same conclusion.
Your conclusion is wrong.
Coffee. Black. Lukewarm. Now I've told that replicator a dozen times about the temperature of my coffee. It just doesn't seem to want to listen. Almost as if it's got a mind of its own. As difficult as it is to accept, the Doctor is more like that replicator than he is like us.
When you separated me from the collective, you allowed me to evolve into an individual, and you allowed that hologram to evolve as well, to exceed his original programming. And yet now you choose to abandon him. It is unsettling. You say that I am a human being, and yet I am also Borg, part of me not unlike your replicator. Not unlike the Doctor. Will you one day choose to abandon me as well?
When Seven reframes the situation for Janeway as her abandonment of the Doctor, just as he's on the cusp of evolving to something more, Janeway reconsiders her own biases about what the Doctor is and could be, and treats him as a person with the right to know and choose.
I'd like to think I made my decision 18 months ago for all the right reasons. My own biases about what you are had just as much to do with it. At the very least, you deserve to know exactly what happened. If you're willing.
This story is all about our rationality, how we use it as we interact with each other, to treat each other as intrinsically valuable persons, or as objects to use when needed or remove when burdensome. Luckily, this is Star Trek, and our characters rise above this and respect life, even artificial life. And for the fascinating and challenging philosophical maneuvers of this episode, this is why Voyager.